next topic is SOLAS. SOLAS, as the name itself suggests, it is International Convention for the Safety of Life at Sea. So safety of life at sea itself signifies what SOLAS is all about. Now, the first version was adopted in 1914 in response to the Titanic disaster, but it did not come into force due to World War I, which had started. Now, it was supposed to come into force in July 1915, but it did not come. Then the second version was adopted in 1929. The third version was adopted in 1948. The fourth version in 1960, which came into force in 1965. Now, the 1948 version is very important, as this was when the IMO was established. A body was formed to look into the updation of convention. The SOLAS convention was adopted by the United Nations, and IMO was a body which was formed. At that time it was known as Intergovernmental Maritime Consultative Organization. So this happened, and then from 1960, the 1960 marks, the 1960 was the first version which was under the IMO. This was the first task for the IMO, first major task for the IMO, and from 1960 it came to force in 1965. It was amended six times from 1965. That was in 1966, 1967, 1968, 1969, 1971, and 1973. Six amendments had come, and finally a new version was adopted in 1974 to include all these amendments together. Now, the 1974 version includes tacit acceptance. Now, tacit acceptance, as we all know, it came because of the previously followed procedures. The previously followed procedures led to delays in the amendments coming into force, due to which the tacit acceptance procedure had come. In this procedure is that it is believed, it is assumed that the government has already accepted the amendment, unless it presents a positive objection within the specified time. That objection also should be through tacit acceptance. Either the amendment is passed or it is rejected. So in case of rejection to happen, the opposing should be from at least one third of the member states, or whoever is opposing, they should contain at least 50% of the world merchant tonnage. They should consist of the 50% of the constitute 50% of the world's merchant tonnage. So that is about it. Now coming to the SOLAS, the main objective of SOLAS is safety of life at sea. So the contents itself, the main index of the SOLAS itself will give you all the main objectives of SOLAS. So at presently there are 14 chapters in SOLAS. We'll get to it. Now, the main objectives of SOLAS are as follows. So as per the chapters, I have given the objectives. So first and foremost is general provision, then you have construction. So it specifies minimum standards of construction, equipment, and operation. Then it provides specifies minimum standards for fire protection. Then it provides minimum standards of safety, the life-saving appliances, the minimum life-saving appliances to be present on board, the minimum firefighting appliances to be present on board, the minimum cargo securing systems, the International Maritime Dangerous Goods Code, then the minimum safety standards to be followed in navigation, in radio communication, your GMDSS, then the minimum certificates which are required to present as a proof that the ship is compliant. Then additional safety measures for bulk carriers, such as your water ingress alarms. Then your audits, verification of compliance, your harmonious system of surveys and certifications which have come up. Then the ISM as special measures to enhance maritime safety. Then your security, special measures to enhance maritime security, that is ISPS, International Shipport Security and Facility Code. So these are the main objectives which focus all around for the safety of life at sea. These are all the main objectives which SOLAS has incorporated to help us. So our next topic is index of Solus. Now index of Solus need to be by hearted, as well as all the mariners who are appearing for second met orders need to know all the chapters of Solus. They should be present on your fingertips. Coming to the chapters of Solus are as follows. Chapter number 1, general provision. Chapter number 2, construction. Chapter number 2, part 1, construction, structure, subdivision, stability, equipments and installations. Chapter number 2, part 2 is your construction, your fire protection, fire detection and fire extinction. Chapter number 3, life saving appliances. Chapter number 4 is your radio communications. Chapter number 5, safety of navigation. Chapter number 6, carriage of cargoes. Chapter number 7, carriage of dangerous goods. Chapter number 8, nuclear ships. Chapter number 9, your management for safe operation of ships. Chapter number 10 is your safety measures for high speed craft. Chapter number 11, part 1, special measures to enhance maritime safety. Chapter number 11, part 2, special measures to enhance maritime security. Chapter number 12, additional measures for bulk carriers, additional safety measures for bulk carriers. And chapter number 13 is your verification of compliance. Chapter number 14 is your safety measures for ships operating in polar regions. So these are your 14 chapters of Solus, and you need to by heart it, and they should be present on your fingertips for the questions to be asked by the surveyors. That's it. So friends, let's begin with Solus chapter number 2, part 1. Now within this there are few important terms and definitions which we need to remember. For example, bulkhead deck. I'm not listing out all the definitions, I'm just listing the few of them which are important as with respect to second met orals, which I feel important. So the bulkhead deck, it is the uppermost deck up to which the transverse watertight bulkheads are carried. As you can see, this is the transverse section I'm drawing. Consider this as your transverse watertight bulkhead. So this bulkhead, the uppermost bulkhead, this is the uppermost bulkhead. This bulkhead, this is the uppermost deck up to which the transverse watertight bulkheads are carried. So bulkhead deck is this deck. As you can see, this deck is your bulkhead deck. So bulkhead deck, it is the uppermost deck up to which the transverse watertight bulkheads are carried. You have to remember this definition. Coming to margin line. Margin line is a line drawn at least 76 mm below the upper surface of the bulkhead deck at the side. Assuming this is the bulkhead deck, if you look it from side, now this is the bulkhead deck. Now from the bulkhead deck, here itself is a 76 mm below the bulkhead deck is your, this is 76 mm distance. This is your margin line. Coming to the next point is machinery spaces. Machinery space is to be taken as extending from the molded baseline to the margin line, as and between the extreme main transverse watertight bulkhead. Watertight bulkheads. So your margin, your machinery space is as follows. As they said, extending from baseline. I hope everyone knows the baseline. Your baseline extends from, this is your baseline. Baseline is the top of the keel plate is your baseline. The top of the keel plate is your baseline. So this is your baseline. Now from baseline to the margin line. Your margin line is 76 mm below your bulkhead deck. So this region and in lengthwise the region between the extreme main transverse watertight bulkheads. So your one is your collision bulkhead, your main one bulkhead is present in the aft. So this constitutes your machinery space. So machinery space is to be taken as extending from molded baseline to the margin line and between the extreme of the main transverse water tight bulkheads. So that is your machinery space. Coming to weather tight. Weather tight means that in any sea conditions, water will not penetrate into the ship. So that is weather tight. That's about it. Guys, I wish to add up a point over here. Now, weather tight openings are those openings which lie above the bulkhead deck. So these openings are exposed to weather, hence they are weather tight. Weather tight means that in any sea condition, the water will not it won't penetrate into the ship. So that's why it is named as weather tight. And water tight are those openings which lie below the bulkhead deck. They won't allow the water to penetrate within as well as go outside. So those are water tight. Chapter 2.1 of SOLAS, the requirement for emergency source of electrical power in cargo ships as per regulation 43 is as follows. The requirement is for a period of 3 hours, the emergency lightning should be present at every muster station, embarkation station and over the sites. That is, your emergency source of power include your generators, your emergency generators and the accumulators, that is your batteries. Those are your emergency source of electrical power. Now they should be able to provide the power for at least 3 hours at every muster station, embarkation station and over the sites. Coming to the next point, it is 18 hours in all service and accommodation spaces, alleyways, stairways and exits, machinery spaces, cargo pump rooms, your steering gear, control stations, etc. Your navigation lights, GMDSS radio for alarm systems. For these all systems, the emergency source of power should be able to provide power for at least 18 hours and at least for one fire pump if dependent upon the emergency generator for a source of power, it should also be supplied for 18 hours. Now note that for shorter voyages, it is acceptable for less than 18 hours is acceptable, but it should not be less than 12 hours. So the emergency source of electrical power can be less than 18 hours but not less than 12 hours. For shorter voyages in acceptable circumstances. So that is about regulation 43 of chapter 2 of my. Hello friends, so our next let's move on to chapter 2 of the SOLAS. Chapter 2 of 2 represents class A divisions. A class divisions, these are those divisions formed by bulkheads and decks and which comply with the following criteria, which are as follows. The A-class divisions, they are constructed of steel or equivalent material. They are suitably stiffened. They are insulated with approved non-combustible material such that the average temperature of the unexposed side will not rise more than 140 degrees Celsius above the original temperature within the time listed below. That is, for A0 it is 0 minutes, for A15 it is 15 minutes. For A 30 division, it is 30 minutes. For A 60 division, it is 60 minutes. Nor will the temperature of any point, including any joint, rise more than 180 degrees centigrade above the original temperature. This is the requirement for class A division. And A class divisions also are capable of preventing, the construction is such that it should be capable of preventing the passage of smoke and flame to the end of 1 hour standard fire test. Remember, this 1 hour standard fire test to be in accordance with the FTP code. The FTP code is your fire test procedures code. So that is about A class divisions. So our next topic is B class divisions. Now B class divisions are those divisions which are formed by bulkheads and decks, ceilings or linings which comply with the following criteria, which are as follows. They are constructed of a non-combustible, approved non-combustible material. They have an insulation valve such that the average temperature of the unexposed side will not rise more than 140 degrees centigrade above the original temperature, nor will the temperature of any point, including the joints, rise more than 225 degrees centigrade above the original temperature. within the time listed below. That is, for B0 division, it is 0 minutes. For B15 division, it is 15 minutes. And class B divisions are constructed in such a way that they should be capable of preventing the passage of flame to the end of the first half an hour of the standard fire test. This standard fire test should be in accordance with the FTP code, which is your fire test procedures code. That is about B class divisions. Coming to C class divisions, these are divisions constructed of an approved non-combustible material. They need not meet the requirements relative to the passage of smoke and flame. So our next topic is fire main and hydrants. The requirement for fire mains and hydrants as per SCOLAS is as follows. The pipes and hydrants shall be so placed that the fire hoses may be easily coupled to them. That is your pipes and your hydrants. They shall be so placed that the fire hose may be easily coupled to them. Now, the arrangement of pipes and hydrants shall be such as to avoid the possibility of freezing. Now, that is done by the drainage provision shall be provided for the main fire main piping. There should be a drainage provision so that all the water is drained out and freezing does not take place within the piping. Isolation valves shall be installed for all open deck fire main branches used for the purpose other than firefighting. So, isolation valves are helpful in that matter. Now, coming to the diameter of fire mains, the diameter of fire mains shall be sufficient for the effective distribution of maximum required discharge from two fire pumps operating simultaneously. So, this is a requirement. And except that in case of cargo ships, the diameter need to be sufficient for the discharge of 140 cubic meter per hour. This is another requirement for the diameter of fire mains. So, two fire pumps operating simultaneously and discharge of 140 cubic meter per hour is a requirement. That's about it. So the next topic for fire mains and hydrants. The number and position of the hydrants shall be such that at least two jets of water not emanating from the same hydrant, that is each from different hydrants, one of which shall be from a single length of hose and may reach any part of the ship. So that is a requirement. And in cargo spaces, two jets shall reach any part of the space and each from a single length of hose and from two different hydrants. So that is a requirement for fire mains and hydrants. The diameter, previously as discussed, the diameter of the fire hydrant, usually it is two and a half inch. Coming to the pressure of hydrants, which is to be the minimum pressure which is required. For cargo ships, the minimum pressure at all hydrants for vessels of 6000 gross tonnage and above, it is 0.27 Newton per mm square. And for vessels less than 6000 gross tonnage, it is 0.25 Newton per mm square. This is an important question asked by surveyor. So keep it in mind. Now, the maximum pressure at all hydrants shall not exceed that at which the effective control of the fire hose can be demonstrated. So, it should not exceed that pressure at which you cannot handle the fire hose. So, that is the maximum pressure. And minimum pressure, as we all know, is 0.27 Newton per mm square for vessels above 6000 gross tonnage and above. And for vessels of less than 6000 gross tonnage, it is 0.25. And maximum pressure at any hydrants, it shall not exceed the pressure at which the control is lost. So, coming to the number of fire pumps required as per SOLAS. In cargo ships of 1000 gross tonnage and upwards, at least 2 in number of fire pumps are required. And in vessels of less than 1000 gross tonnage, at least 2 power-driven pumps, one of which shall be independently driven. So that's the requirement for the number of fire pumps as per SOLAS. And the total capacity of fire pumps as per SOLAS is as follows. In cargo ships other than emergency pumps, the total required capacity of fire pump need not exceed 180 cubic meter per hour. That is 180 cubic meter of water to be supplied per hour by the fire pumps is a requirement, and every such fire pump shall have a capacity of not less than 80% of the total required capacity, required capacity divided by the minimum number of fire pumps required. But in any case, it should not be less than 25 cubic meter per hour. That is, the amount of water to be delivered in any case should be not less than 25 cubic meter per hour. That's the requirement. So, and each pump shall in any event be capable of delivering at least 2 required jets of water. So that's another requirement. So this concludes the number of fire pumps and the minimum requirement for the total capacity of fire pumps as per SOLIS. So friends, coming to our continuing the topic of fire hoses. So fire hoses shall have a length of at least 10 meters. So the 10 meters is the requirement under SOLAS, but not less than 15 meters in machinery spaces. It should be the length of the fire hose should be not less than 20 meters in open decks and other spaces, and the length of the fire hose should be not less than 25 meters for open decks on ships with maximum breadth exceeding 30 meters. So where the breadth of the deck exceeds 30 meters, there the minimum requirement of the length of the fire hose is 25 meters. Coming to for cargo ships of 1000 gross tonnage and upwards, the requirement as per SOLAS for fire hoses is as follows. The number of fire hoses to be provided shall be one each for 30 meter length of the ship and one spare, but in no case less than 5 in all for the length of the ship of 1000 gross tonnage and upwards. So that is iska matlab 1000 GRT ka jo aapka vessel hai, 1000 GRT se upar agar hai, to us case mein har 30 meter ke daire mein ek fire hose maujood hona chahiye. उस चीज़ की रिक्वायरमेंट है, और एक फायर होस स्पेयर में होना चाहिए, और किसी भी समय में 5 फायर होस से कम नहीं होना चाहिए पूरी जहाज पे. सो दैट इज द रिक्वायरमेंट. एंड 3 एडिशनल होजेस एंड नॉजल्स फॉर शिप्स कैरिंग डेंजरस गुड्स. सो दिस इज अनदर रिक्वायरमेंट. एंड फॉर कार्गो शिप्स ऑफ लेस देन 1000 ग्रॉस टनेज, द रिक्वायरमेंट इज द इट शुड बी एज पर द प्रोविजंस the number of fire hoses, but in no case it should be not less than 3. So in any case, not less than 3 for ships less than 1000 gross tonnage. Coming to the standard sizes of nozzle, the standard sizes of nozzle as per SOLAS is 12 mm, 16 mm, and 19 mm. Now note, nozzle size greater than 12 mm need not be used for accommodation spaces and service spaces. So 16 mm and 19 mm cannot be used in accommodation spaces and service spaces. Only 12 mm and only 12 mm can be used. Coming to machinery spaces, in machinery spaces the standard size of the nozzle need not exceed 19 mm. So a nozzle beyond 19 mm is not allowed for machinery spaces. So these are the standard sizes of nozzles. Coming to portable fire extinguishers. Now, portable fire extinguishers, the type and design of the portable fire extinguishers should comply with the International Code for Fire Safety Systems, and this is for as per SOLAS itself for RoRo ships. It shall be provided, the portable fire extinguisher should be provided at each deck level and in each hold or compartment where vehicles are carried. Now they should be spaced not more than 20 meter apart on both the sides of the space. So 20 meter on both the sides of the spaces. Now in RoRo, for special spaces with vehicles with fuel, at least 3 water foam applicators and 1 portable foam applicator unit should be provided, complying with the International Code for Fire Safety Systems, and provided that at least 2 such units should be present on board for use in such spaces. So this is the requirement for portable fire extinguishers. We'll be continuing portable fire extinguishers. So continuing with portable fire extinguishers, the arrangements shall be as such: in accommodation spaces, service spaces, and control stations shall be provided with portable fire extinguishers of appropriate type and in sufficient number to the satisfaction of the administration. So the administration is given the right to decide on the number of the portable fire extinguishers required in accommodation spaces, service spaces and control stations. Now, ships of 1000 gross tonnage and upwards shall carry at least 5 portable fire extinguishers, and one of the portable fire extinguishers intended for use in any space shall be stored near the entrance to that space. This point is important. Carbon dioxide or your CO2 fire portable fire extinguishers not to be placed in the accommodation spaces, and portable fire extinguishers should be situated at easily visible places which can be reached quickly in case of fire. And it should be placed in spaces where it is not impaired by severe weather or vibrations or any other factor from ship. Now, fire extinguishers shall be provided with devices which indicate whether they have been used. So we have pressure gauge which is present, which is attached to the fire extinguisher. So this is all about the arrangements. And remember, your pressure gauges, they indicate if any leak has happened or the extinguisher has been used. You look for the green patch. The indication should always show the green patch. If it is in the red patch, that means your fire extinguisher has leaked or it has been used. So you need to either do the maintenance or get a new fire extinguisher. That's about it.